Welcome back to the Million Dollar Problems. This is our final episode, and it's a special one. Well, it's because for the first time, we're going to discuss a problem that has actually been solved. We are talking about the Poincaré Conjecture, the seventh and final problem in our series on the Clay Institute's Millennium Prize Puzzles.
Poincaré conjecture is the only Millennium Prize problem to be conquered, and its solution not only reshaped our understanding of 3D spaces, but also completed a monumental program in mathematics. For over a century, this problem stood as a towering challenge in topology, and when Grigori Perelman solved it, he did more than just answer a century-old question. He changed the way we think about the shape of our universe.
And if I remember right, he declined both a million-dollar prize and the Fields Medal, a true enigma of the math world.
Exactly. But the impact of his solution goes beyond the headlines. Today, we're going to explore what this problem really means, how it connects to the very fabric of the universe, and why its solution is a landmark in human thought. To understand the Poincaré conjecture, we need to step into the world of topology. This is the branch of mathematics that studies shapes and spaces in their most flexible forms. Imagine you're working with a material like clay. You can stretch it, twist it, or bend it, but you can't tear it or glue pieces together. Topology cares about the properties that remain unchanged under such transformations.
Oh, it's less about the details like size or angles and more about the big picture of how a shape connects and holds together.
Exactly. Now, think about a coffee cup and a donut. They might look completely different, but in topology, they're considered the same. It's because you can reshape a coffee cup into a donut by stretching it, the handle of the cup becomes the hole in the donut.
Oh, right. But I'm guessing a shape like pretzel throws a wrench into that logic.
It does. A pretzel has more than one hole, so topologically it's different from a donut or coffee cup. And this brings us to the Poincaré conjecture. Imagine a 3D shape. The conjecture asks, if every loop you draw on the surface of this shape can shrink to a single point without tearing the surface, does that mean the shape is a 3D sphere?
Wait, well, let's unpack that. What do you mean by shrinking a loop to a point?
Picture this. Take a rubber band and stretch it around the surface of a balloon. Now, slowly tighten the rubber band. On a balloon, you can shrink it all the way down to a single dot without breaking the surface. But if you try this on a donut, you'll find that some loops, like one that goes around the hole, can't shrink because they get stuck.
So the conjecture is basically asking if this property, shrinking loops, is enough to guarantee that the shape is a sphere?
Exactly. Imagine the balloon again. The Poincaré conjecture says that if a 3D shape behaves like a balloon in this way, where every loop can shrink, then it must be a sphere, topologically speaking.
That's quite an idea, but why did proving it take over a century?
The challenge lay in the dimension. In 2D, this idea had been proven long ago. If you think of a flat disk or a 2D sphere, the concept is intuitive. But in 3D, the mathematical tools needed were far more intricate. Mathematicians had solved similar problems in higher dimensions, but the 3D case was uniquely stubborn.
Okay, but let's get practical. Why does this conjecture matter? Does it help us build better coffee cups?
It matters because 3D spaces are everywhere. The Poincaré conjecture is foundational to understanding the geometry of the universe. Picture the cosmos as a vast 3D shape. Is it finite but unbounded, like the surface of a balloon? Or is it something even stranger? This conjecture helps us explore those possibilities. The techniques developed to solve the Poincaré conjecture, particularly Ricci flow, have applications beyond pure math. They've influenced fields like medical imaging, data science, and even theoretical physics. To truly understand the Poincaré conjecture, we have to go back to the mind of Henri Poincaré himself. It was 1904 when Poincaré was exploring the fundamental nature of shapes, not just the way they appear, but their essence. Imagine you're holding a balloon. Its surface is smooth, and any loop drawn on it can shrink to a point. But how do you know it's truly a sphere? What if it's something more complex, hiding its true shape? This question fascinated Poincaré. He wanted to know, could this shrinking loop property guarantee that a shape is a sphere in three dimensions?
But she was trying to get to the core identity of shapes, like asking what really makes a sphere a sphere.
Exactly. His work was driven by the growing field of topology, which studies the properties of shapes that remain unchanged when you stretch or deform them. Poincaré's conjecture was the first step in a much larger vision. He was laying the groundwork to classify all possible shapes, not just in three dimensions, but across all dimensions. He was asking a question that felt intuitive, but had profound implications. What's ironic is that in higher dimensions, the problem turned out to be easier. In the 1960s, Steve Smale solved the equivalent of the Poincaré conjecture for dimensions 5 and higher, showing that such shapes were spheres if they had the shrinking loop property. Then, in the 1980s, Michael Friedman cracked the four-dimensional case, earning a Fields Medal.
Wait a second. Why would higher dimensions be easier? Shouldn't it be backward, as we see for most problems?
It feels counterintuitive, doesn't it? But in higher dimensions, mathematicians had more room. Literally, they could manipulate shapes and bypass obstacles more easily because there were fewer constraints on how the space behaved. Think of it as trying to untangle a knot. In 3D, you're stuck with only so much room to maneuver. In higher dimensions, you have more ways to work around the knot. The three-dimensional case resisted every attempt because it required new tools, tools that didn't exist yet. And that's where Richard Hamilton's Ricci flow came in. Think of Ricci flow as a way to smooth out a shape. Imagine you're holding a crumpled piece of clay. If you heat it up and let it melt slightly, it starts to flow and smooth itself out. That's what Ricci flow does mathematically. It's a process that changes the shape of a manifold, a 3D space, over time, ironing out the wrinkles. Hamilton introduced Ricci flow in the 1980s and showed that it could transform certain 3D shapes into spheres. But there was a catch. During the process, singularities could form, points where the shape essentially tears or collapses. Hamilton's methods couldn't handle these singularities.
So it was like trying to smooth out clay that keeps cracking?
Precisely. But Hamilton's work laid the foundation. He showed that Ricci flow could be a powerful tool if someone could figure out how to deal with the singularities. And that's where Grigori Perelman came in. Grigori Perelman was unlike anyone else in the mathematical world. Born in Leningrad in 1966, he was a prodigy from a young age. His mother recognized his talent early and enrolled him in a rigorous math program. By the time he was 16, he had won a gold medal at the International Mathematical Olympiad with a perfect score. Even though he was a prodigy and respected mathematician at the time of his solution, Perelman was intensely private and focused solely on the pursuit of truth in mathematics. After completing his PhD, he worked in both the US and Russia, contributing to some of the most challenging problems in geometry. But he always preferred solitude over the spotlight. In 2002, Perelman posted a series of papers online outlining his proof of the Poincaré conjecture. His work built on Hamilton's Ricci flow and introduced new techniques to handle the singularities. Imagine performing surgery on a shape, carefully cutting away the problem areas and stitching it back together. That's essentially what Perelman's techniques did. His proof was so dense and groundbreaking that it took the mathematical community years to verify it. But by 2006, it was universally accepted.
Hey, so how did the world react? Did Perelman finally step into the spotlight?
Far from it. The mathematical community was in awe, but Perelman himself shunned the recognition. He declined the Fields Medal, mathematics' highest honor, and turned down the $1 million Millennium Prize from the Clay Mathematics Institute.
Wait, he turned down $1 million? Why?
Perelman felt that the prizes were unnecessary. He once said, "I'm not interested in money or fame. I don't want to be on display like an animal in a zoo." But the drama didn't end there. A group of mathematicians initially tried to claim part of the credit for his work, leading to a tense controversy. But Perelman didn't care about the drama either. He retreated further into seclusion, leaving his job at the Steklov Institute in St. Petersburg. Today, he lives quietly in Russia, completely removed from the public eye.
So the man who solved a century-old problem simply walked away?
Exactly. His story is a reminder that for some, the pursuit of knowledge is its own reward. Perelman's breakthrough didn't just solve the Poincaré conjecture. It completed something even larger, the geometrization conjecture, a landmark in topology that helps us understand the possible shapes of 3D spaces. This wasn't just about proving one theorem. It was about giving mathematicians a framework to classify every possible 3D manifold.
So it's like he didn't just find one missing puzzle piece, he completed the entire picture?
Exactly. His work unified decades of mathematical thought and confirmed ideas that had been floating around for years. One of the biggest implications was in theoretical physics. The Poincaré conjecture, through the lens of the geometrization conjecture, gives us tools to think about the shape of the universe itself. Think of the universe as a vast 3D manifold. Perelman's work doesn't directly tell us the shape of the universe, but it gives us the mathematical tools to explore the possibilities. Are we living in a finite but unbounded space? Could the universe have a shape we haven't even imagined? These are the kinds of questions his work helps us approach. And the ripple effects go even further. Perelman's techniques, particularly his refinements to Ricci flow, have influenced fields like data analysis and network theory. For example, understanding how data flows in complex networks can draw on the same principles used to smooth out manifolds.
So a breakthrough in topology is now helping us understand everything from social networks to medical imaging?
Yes, I mean, you know this, that's the beauty of mathematics. A solution in one field often reverberates across others in ways we couldn't predict. So this exploration brings us to the end of our journey into the Millennium Prize problems. But as we wrap up this series, it's worth asking, what's next?
You mean for the Millennium Prize problem?
Exactly. There are still 6 unsolved problems, each representing a monumental challenge. From the mysteries of the Riemann hypothesis to the intricacies of quantum field theory, these problems are pushing the frontiers of human knowledge. And that's what this series has been about, celebrating the power of questions, the beauty of curiosity, and the incredible capacity of the human mind to solve even the most daunting puzzles.
It's been a privilege to explore these mysteries, and who knows, maybe someone listening right now will be encouraged to give a shot to solving the next millennium problem.
That's the hope, Inara. And on that note, we want to thank all of you for joining us on this journey. Together, we've explored the deepest questions in mathematics, the stories of the people who asked them, and the remarkable breakthroughs that have changed the world. So here's to the next big question, and the people brave enough to attempt to answer them.